The Dallas Cowboys defeated the LA Rams in their second preseason bout. I thought it was dope. It seems like when Mike White came onto the field, we just lost all the mojo. That'll be a whole nother video. However, there is some optimism about the first team that I just want to share with you. I got a handful of notes I just want to share with you. First of all, don't let the peanut gallery tell you that, oh, this doesn't matter. It's just preseason. You are playing against backups. Well, if it's like a talent versus talent exchange, maybe you can use the backup excuse, but there are a handful of preseason evaluations that really doesn't have much to do with the exact talent matchup, and I'm gonna talk you through some of those things. And I do have some talent based stuff that I want to talk about, but I'm gonna mix all this into one big pot of gumbo. All right, let's jump into it. Let's take a look at this first play. Right, this first play that I really thought was interesting. This is about four plays into the drive. I care nothing about the pre-snap motion. That doesn't really drive me crazy like it drives other people crazy. Now, if you're a Cowboys fan, you know the Cowboys, they have this thing that we did last season with Dak at quarterback. We will be driving, we'll look good, then we'll run into a little bit of adversity, like a sack here. Now, what happened on this sack? Well, there was a gap exchange here. Lael had someone cross his face, but 97 right here. Yeah, 97 hit B gap here, but Lael Collins didn't look outside of him. So not only did this guy run kind of free past Lael, but Tony Pollard got kind of wide with his play action fake. If he was a little more narrow, he could have hit this guy in the chest. Lael would have hit his guy if he was, you know, better, and Dak would have hit Jason Witten wide open right here. Now, that's what should have happened, but you know, we have adversity when we run across these things, right? Now, normally when this happens in the regular season, it ends up being second and forever. The drive stalls and everything looks bad. We punt the football. What I like is that we were able to overcome this adversity in the next few plays. Let's watch this. What I noticed on this play about Tony Pollard, I care nothing about that pre-snap motion, is I didn't notice how Tony ran with his eyes. Like, he's really good at running with his eyes, and he understands his running back leverage. Every position in football, they all have a different leverage that you kind of got to understand, but Tony running with his eyes, he really has a good leverage, like big boy type leverage, right? First of all, he's gonna get the handoff. He's gonna start off wide, right? Wide, wide, wide. But if you look at Tony's eyes, he's keyed in on this gallop block right here. Now, he could go outside, but it's not really safe out there. If you go outside of Gallup's block, you're either going to run out of space and end up out of bounds. You're going to end up getting a free release from 31 here. And that's eventually what happens here. Like, 31 has that outside leverage. However, if Gallup goes inside, if Tony goes inside, it's more space to navigate here. It's more field to work with. So he did. Now, take a look at Tony starting wide, seeing it, then cutting upfield. Take a look at this. Just look at him. Outside, upfield. Real tight off of Xavier Suafilo's block right there. I just think that's a big boy move, man. Some of these running backs that lack vision, they'll go outside and stay outside. Or they'll round this thing up and they'll end up really close to Gallup. I like how he cut it off so precisely that, man, look, I ain't got to get close to Gallup. I'm going to work this thing inside and then I'm going to finish with a little bit of toughness on the back end of the run. That's what I like the most. Me and Foots keep telling y'all, Tony Pollard is not a scat back. Just because he catches the ball doesn't mean he's a third down back. Just because he look kind of skinny, he don't look all that thick in the body and arms, he's not a scat back. He's running with power. He's finishing people. Let's keep watching. I got another example of that. If y'all go back and watch my old Michael Gallup college film session, I said that once he develops, he's going to do a lot of Dez things. That's not an exaggeration. This is 3rd and 7 right here. First of all, I kind of like the aggression in the play call there, that is 3rd and 7. We're not going to do something over the middle that's kind of easy. We're going to hit you outside the numbers for something way, way bigger than 7 yards. I kind of like that. But this is mostly on Gallup here. Now, this is the one play to where the talent versus talent exchange really matters, right? This is Michael Gallup versus like a second string corner or something like that. Cool. I want you to do these things against, you know, second level corners. Because I tell you what, we're going to end up playing teams like the Giants. So we're going to play other teams that got bad corners. The Eagles had bad corners last year. They've yet to address the cornerback position. Cool. Then we're going to get easier matchups versus easier corners. So in this preseason evaluation, yes, Michael Gallup did Dez things versus a less superior corner. But if we go against a team with a less superior corner, at least we know now that this is a matchup to where Michael Gallup can do Dez things. That's what I'm trying to teach people. That's how I'm trying to teach people how to watch preseason football. It's not always about the talent that's on the field. How does your player interact with the player that's across from him? And now we learned that Michael Gallup can do Dez things versus whack corner. So now we get to play mismatch. Something else I like about it too is where Dak placed the ball. Like, the ball ain't always got to be way in front of Gallup for him to speed past 31 and catch it. I like sometimes when we can just do 50-50 ball stuff. I think that's kind of fun. We don't always have to put Gallup in a situation where he has to catch the ball and, you know, run past the guy like in stride. Like, it doesn't always have to be one of those situations. I like these jump ball type of deals, these 50-50 joints. In this drive, Dak was perfect, and what I like the most about it is that he just spread the ball around. Now, we always feel like we have talent and that we got plenty of guys that can go for the ball. Dak completed passes to, what, four different receivers? Tony Gallup, Randall Cobb, and Jason Witten. So I like the range that we have in this offense in terms of getting the ball to different, you know, different guys. There's one to Randall Cobb. My cable bill was way too high. I reached out to affordablesticks.com. They sent me a Fire Stick, plugged that thing into the HDMI. Now I get unlimited shows, movies, and live TV. I'm a huge sports fan, so I love League Pass, Sunday Ticket, and I get the pay-per-view fights for free. That's something for the whole family. You can buy a Fire Stick for every TV in the house and still spend less money than you would on cable. That's affordablesticks.com. There's a link in my description. You should go click it.
Cut the cord.
One to Jason Witten, him being rusty off that ESPN booth right here. Now, this is something interesting that I got from this play. Like I said, there's always something you can learn about preseason football that's not necessarily talent versus talent. Jason Witten is detached up top here. I find that interesting. Jason Witten, mostly in his old age, he runs a lot of, if I'm detached, I'm going to be in the slot, or he's really like an inline type tight end, and he's running routes from his three-point stance. It's rare that we see Jason Witten not only detached but up top by himself or down bottom by himself, just whatever kind of leverage that we're working with. We see the Patriots do this with Gronk all the time. Last year when he was playing, we saw Gronk wide open, detached, you know, up top by himself. And you know, if Jason Witten is going to be your man beater, if Jason Witten is going to be your mismatch versus corner guy, I kind of dig it a little bit. And here's Tony doing Tony things again. He's going to catch the ball here. But the good thing about Tony catching the ball is that he turns into a runner again, right? Like, he's not just catching the ball and getting down like some slot receiver that left us and went to Buffalo. Like, he's actually catching the ball and he's running through people. Now, at some point, like I said, this is preseason. So when we get to the Giants game or these other regular season games, we're going to see Tony Pollard lined up in the slot. We may see Tony lined up outside. Tony's going to be in the backfield. He's going to motion out. We're going to see Tony do a lot of different things. But as of now, we have Tony Pollard out of the backfield catching the ball, running people over because he's not a scat back. I'm going to talk about Tony Pollard here because this is the play that he scored on. There's plenty to say about it. But, man, I like O-line porn just as much as the next person. But, man, this is a different kind of filth right here. People ask me all the time, Vach, you know, what are we getting with Travis that we didn't get with Joe? Joe was good. Like, are we that much better with Travis? Let me tell you something, man. Joe can't do this. Look at where 97's lined up at. He's lined up on the outside shoulder of Xavier Suofilo here. And Travis is going to get there. Travis is going to get there. Now, if this was Zach Martin, oh boy. If this was Zach Martin, he would have pounded 97 kind of into Travis and climbed to 24 and made this like real seamless, made it soft as a Krispy Kreme donut, made it cut like butter. However, Xavier Suofilo is not Zach Martin. But for Travis to be able to reach like this, man, that's fantastic blocking. And what it did was it kind of gave Tony like this safety gap to kind of hit right here. I was talking about Tony's vision earlier. Take a look at Tony's eyes right here, right? Boom. Look at his eyes. He's working outside, working outside, working outside. Still outside, but he sees. He sees this little crease backside opening up right here. And Connor Williams does a pretty okay job of cutting this guy off. It's just that Connor loses footing or whatever. But even with Connor losing his footing, Tony Pollard is not a scat back. And he's going to run through this guy, right? He's going to run through this arm tackle. And that says a lot about his balance. You know, people want to compare Tony Pollard to Alvin Kamara. I'm not calling him that guy. But one thing that Alvin Kamara is really good at is his balance after contact. Like, you just can't arm tackle Alvin Kamara. And boy, oh boy, is that lovely. Then on top of that, will somebody call Foots the King and check up on him? Because, yes, Foots loved Tony Pollard, but Foots also loved Taylor Rapp. And Tony Pollard kind of ran over Taylor Rapp to get into the end zone. And old Tony Pollard got up and flexed on everybody. Hey, man, this was pretty fun. It was pretty interesting to look at. Like I said, when Mike White got back on the field, you know, the whole mojo kind of went away or whatever. I will say, I think Cooper Rush retired Mike White tonight, because we noticed the order and the depth chart switch, right? Like, last week it was Coop then Mike. This week it was Mike then Coop. I guess they did that because, okay, let's give Mike a better O-line to play behind and you know, better receivers, and let's see if Mike can do better. Well, Mike was just as bad and Coop was just as good as he was last year. So with Cooper Rush going out there with, you know, Campos on the line and Mitch Hyatt on the other side, the same guys that, you know, Mike White had, and he was able to move the ball and score, and, you know, we won the game because of that score, then I think Cooper Rush fully cut Mike White from this team. So that's another development that we'll talk about later. Hey, man, appreciate y'all for tuning in. Like, hit the subscribe button. Shouts out to affordablesticks.com, all that good stuff. I'll catch y'all next time, man. Peace. YouTube Illuminati is taking money away from your favorite content creators, and people often ask the best way to support the channel directly. I tell them that's subscribing to my Patreon. Just $1 a month would increase production and the frequency of uploads. Basically, that means more content for you. For less than a bag of almond M&Ms, you can support the channel, call dibs on requests for future videos, and you can have access to Patreon exclusive material like my throwback film sessions. That's patreon.com/VachLombardi. I appreciate the support. Doski Woski. Salute.